Campbell, the president of the National Hockey League, out there at center ice. There's Ted Green. See him brushing the tears away from his eyes. The rest of the Bruins.
There has never been, to this point at least, a more fetching image of the Bruins. How they cavorted that grand May Day exactly 20 years ago, when that rollicking collection celebrated as the Big Bad Bruins won their first Stanley Cup. What radiated through that scene was a sense of oneness, of comradeship, the spirit of being one happy band of brothers.
The Bruins have won the Stanley Cup for the first time in 29 years. Jusek brings that cup down to the other end of the ice. He wants all the fans to have a look at it.
I don't believe I've ever seen a more emotional scene than the one in Boston. The love of the players for their fans.
And there they go, the Boston Bruins skating off with the Stanley Cup. Johnny Jusek having it high over his head.
But the important point is that through all the years, the meager as well as the grand, they have retained that code, that ethic. In good days and bad, the Bruins are a team. They stand up, they don't whine, and they are loyal to one another. It is their calling card, their most attractive feature, and it's a quality the players seem to pass on down through the years without thinking about it or even realizing that it's happening. The old garden has housed other teams, other games, and thousands of events both memorable and long forgotten. But it's been the Bruins who have always been the meal ticket of this place, and they have had a special hold here. As one garden official, not associated with any team, confided, the Bruins are family. All the other acts in this building are just business. And so, what of that family? It's really been a royal lineage, more so than latter generations can begin to understand. The Bruins celebrated the very birth of this building with a championship the first year of its existence. It was a powerful team, featuring Dick Clapper, Harry Oliver, Dutch Gaynor, Cooney Weiland, Tiny Thompson in goal, and above all, the volcanic Eddie Shore.
Now Shore starts lumbering up the ice, skating over onto the right wing, up to center ice, moving in close, and Shore...
They called him the Edmonton Express, for he came out of the Canadian Rockies like a cold, savage gale. He was one of the surest, fiercest, most troubled talents ever to play anything.
He was, without a doubt, the toughest, meanest guy I've ever seen in my life. But it was a funny thing. He was just a little guy. Everybody thinks he was big. He was just a little guy. There was something about him, animal magnetism, is that what you call it? We were afraid of him. Big guy, 6 foot five, 6 foot four. We were afraid of the guy.
No minor character himself, the irascible Don Cherry once played what seemed an eternity for Shore when Shore owned the minor league Springfield Indians.
I'm not a hypocrite. He was not a good friend of mine. I played for him for 3.5 years at Eddie's rottenness. I know he was him and Bobby Orr were probably the two greatest defensemen that ever lived. But boy, he made my life a living hell down there. And I can't say he's a friend of mine.
Shore was a surpassing, almost avenging force. And one night on the ice, he nearly killed Toronto's ace Bailey in a terrible outburst of temper. If Shore forged hockey here with his Vulcan spirit, it was three engaging German kids from Kitchener, Ontario, who gave it charm. Called the Krauts, Milt Schmidt, Bobby Bauer, and Woody Dumont brought noble innocence to the product, helped make it family entertainment. They were a special mix of talent and decency.
I can remember standing at attention while they were playing the national anthem. In those days, the trains came right underneath the station. And when the trains would come in, while the floor, while the national anthem was being played, would vibrate. And there you were standing there, you were just shaking from the trains going underneath. Therefore, this surface here was never level. Some of the ice would be maybe a quarter of an inch, and other places would be a half inch. But where it was a quarter of an inch, you'd be hitting cement there before the night was over, and the sparks would be flying and all over the place.
It was a team so fine only a world war could break it up. There was Mr. Zero, Frankie Brimsek in goal, and such lyric artists as Roy Conacher and Bill Cowley.
We were on the bench, and we saw Cowley and Conacher break away against the defense. And Roy get the puck. It was just a matter of putting it up on the scoreboard. I mean, you're almost that sure that he was going to score goals.
Coached by benevolent despot Art Ross, no minor legend himself, they won two Stanley Cups, then departed for war. The night the Krauts left for the Royal Canadian Air Force, they were carried off the ice by the players while the crowd sang Auld Lang Syne. It would be a quarter of a century before the Bruins would again be mighty. In the 50s, they were earnest and honest, but in what would become a familiar tale, never good enough to beat the Canadiens and the savage Rocket Richard.
You can see it, I think, in all really great athletes. They got a tremendous desire to win, whether they're playing cards or marbles or hockey or whatever it is. And he had a burning desire, and he had that tremendous spirit. And he did have those dark eyes, and they would flash. They would be seem to be, you know, just flashing at nights.
And then in 66, an electrifying man-child came out of Parry Sound, Ontario, Bobby Orr. Orr had a cultural impact, transcending his game. The rage his big bad Bruins excited infected the region, making passionate fans of people who thought icing was something that happened to your windshield. And so the big bad Bruins came of age. Orr was their genius, but there was brilliance all through their ranks.
They were a collection of really good players, but they're also a collection of guys who didn't take themselves too seriously. And they were able to enjoy life and also show up for work with all the intensity necessary to play at top form and top level. And that was the distinction between that team and many others, is that when it came time to play, they really knew how to play.
Everything they did was big and loud. Phil Esposito, their prolific and so very Roman scoring machine, epitomized the style. They destroyed scoring records wholesale and exulted in every last spree. They were robust and rowdy.
Everybody backed up each other. If you needed help, you got it in any category. We just had such a great blend.
We had a lot of problems too, but there was an understanding that you had to do your job. If you didn't do your job, not only were you told by the coach and so on, you know, the players were all over you pretty good too. So that was the kind of relationship we had. We were a close group on and off the ice, and it was very important to our success.
And still going to Bobby Hull, back in front. Great stick save by Chambers.
And so they won two cups, but they should have won more, maybe two or three more. Some said they were too cocky, others that they were having too much fun. And there's no question that they had plenty of that. This was the Gas House Gang of its era.
Well, we were known as the Big Bad Bruins, but I think our off-ice activities were as well publicized as our on-ice activities.
The steaming May Sunday matinee that brought them the cup was one of the very choicest moments in Boston sports history. Child Bobby's give and go with Derek Sanderson that produced the winning goal will always be a frozen moment, hanging there, forever green.
Bobby Orr, behind the net to Sanderson, to Orr! Bobby Orr scores in the Boston Bruins! The Bruins will stand the cup! Orr!
When you sit and think about it, it becomes very clear in your mind. You can remember exactly what you're thinking, where you were sitting on the bench and everything. And it was sort of the highlight of everyone's career. We dreamed of winning a Stanley Cup, and we became a young team, and the city sort of fell in love with the team, and the team fell in love with the city, and we were on, had great success, and it was a great time in our lives.
Over 20 years, you saw a lot of great championship romps, but there was never another that came close to this one. The locker room bash was Homeric, soon to be surpassed by the frothing, screeching carnival of a civic love fest that ended with everyone being drenched in suds at City Hall. This is how and where they cemented their legend.
Every time I think back to that team, I get a grin, because we had a lot of fun. And I don't think, once again, that you can win a championship without having fun and enjoying everyone.
They won again 2 years later, and again it was loud and zany and full of fun. But already they had begun to lose their fabulous edge. Player raids from a new league were a factor, so was expansion. But injuries were even more so, particularly the mean cuts that kept dropping Orr. At 25, he was already on borrowed time. Orr was finished, just when he might have been reaching his prime. He was receiving the sort of tributes ancients and relics receive when he should have still been at the pinnacle. It wasn't fair. The night they lifted his number to the rafters was surely grand and as tender as any building has ever seen. But it was also exquisitely sad.
This is a heck of a place. I love you and thank you very much.
And so there followed the Don Cherry years, when the Band of Brothers theme was brought to full flower. An irascible Beau Brummel, who wanted you to believe he was descended from Lord Horatio Nelson, Cherry's style was to circle his wagons and take on the world. His Bruins were tough and maybe a little wacky.
Bouchard and Jonathan. Oh, Jonathan ripped a couple of sun. Oh, look at this heavyweight battle. Look at Jonathan go. Jonathan. Oh, won that clearly.
They almost pulled it off. Their signature, written in flames as well as tears, was the glorious too many men on the ice fiasco in the Montreal Forum. To be sure, there were too many of them out there, six skaters waltzing about for fully 10 seconds, trying to protect a one-goal lead in the last minutes against the Canadiens, with a winner sure to win the cup. The rest, as they say, is history.
Leads Lemaire. Back to Lafleur, the shot scored! Guy Lafleur! Tremblay breaks with Lambert at far left. Tremblay moving deep. Centers it.
I never seen a team try so hard and not win. It was just, I mean, I want to cry for them. I look at them and I feel so much for them that they were great. I never seen a team try so hard.
And so the Don Cherry years ended as only they could have, with grapes going out on his shield. It was a Viking funeral. In the decade that followed, the Bruins remained earnest and respectable, but all of that was never quite good enough.
The composite Bruin team of the 80s played hard, was plenty tough, had lots of injuries, finished second, then got whacked early in the playoffs, usually by Montreal. Four straight years, the hated Habs beat them in the first round.
Three on two for the moment for Tremblay. Back for Nesman. In front. He's checked and scores! With 51 seconds left, Nesman wins it for the Montreal Canadiens. Nasland checked deep. Now with it, Neely trying to break
it. It was all of that, plus a long train of abuses dating back a half century that made the vanquishing of the Canadiens in the spring of 88 the pinnacle of their decade.
Here he comes along, shorthanded. He's in. He is stopped and scored by Sweeney in the final. Sweeney. Shea over the line. A fake on Wesley cuts right in. And a most marvelous save by Reggie Lemelin. Ahead for Neely. Neely trying to cut in. Hull down, gets it again. He's in. He scores! Cam Neely from Bob Screen. He makes it 4-1 on a breakaway.
The dispelling of the Canadian curse was their cup for the 80s.
45 years of dust, man.
Some glorious farce followed. The defeat of New Jersey featured Jim Schoenfeld, the irate coach of the Devils, and Don Koharski, the plump referee, in the celebrated donut controversy.
You're crazy.
I'm not hoping so.
You're crazy. You're not good because you fell, you fat pig. Have another donut. Have another donut.
Mighty Edmonton might have swept the finals had not the garden lights gone out in Game 4, forcing the evacuation of their fans and underscoring again the glories of their old building. Back in Edmonton, Wayne Gretzky, in his last game as an Oiler, swiftly finished the task.
Gretzky on a power play goal. He was wide open.
Maybe there were no cups for the faithful, but they got their money's worth. In a patented hockey moment, Ray Bourque surrendered his number so that it could be hoisted in permanent tribute to Phil Esposito. There may have been no cups in the 80s, but there were plenty of moments.
The draw, the shot, it trickles in, it's knocked away, Park with it, scores! Brad Park wins the game! A rebound, and the Bruins win! Middleton trying to move right in, scores! And a fantastic goal by Rick Middleton!
There's O'Reilly over the line, bearing in, going in, and scores! A miraculous goal by Terry O'Reilly! Scores! Cam Neely, a beautiful individual effort!
It bounces free, and the Bruins get it. Here comes Bourque. Bourque breaks by one man, Van Boxmeer. Avoids a shot. Oh, and a goal by Bourque all the way from the Bruins' end.
So they come again to the brink. Whatever the result, you can say this for them. It's a stand-up-and-be-counted game, and they've always accepted that and never played it.